Thank you, Professor Ghosh, panelists, ladies and gentlemen. I'll be talking about Nepal-India relations. Has cultural commonality helped? I'm thankful to Smriti, and Smriti has also been the person to give me this topic. So I've tried to think a few ideas around the topic that was provided to me. Nepal-India relations are a very peculiar kind of a relation. Yesterday we heard about the need for visa restrictions to be eased. You know, you do not have visa restrictions for travel between Nepal and India for Nepali and Indian citizens. You need some identification that you are a national of the particular country, but that's all. You know, only a very small minuscule of people travel via air. You know, a lot of people travel via the land. There's free movement of people. You know, thousands of people cross the Nepali side into India side and from India side to the Nepali side. You know, it could be like a border between, say, Gujarat and Maharashtra, you know, except for a few checkpoints of Suraksha Sima Bal here and there. So you have thousands of people moving across the border. Now, you don't even have barbed wire. You know, there is no barbed wire, you know, no wire. People can move across easily. And then because of the relative ease with which people travel and goods travel, Nepal has, in fact, in the past few years, tried to synchronize its own trade and finance and fiscal policies with that of India. You know, if not, it would be very difficult to basically, you know, maintain a very different kind of trade regime. So in spite of all this, ups and downs and frosty relationships develop, as we have seen during the past few weeks. Now, before I go into the paper, I'll mention some of my limitations up front. I'm not an international relations person. I'm not an area specialist. Neither do I have a background that enables me to comment on the constitution. I am a sociologist by training, and it is as a lay Nepali that I approach this issue. I acknowledge my identity as a Hill Brahmin, and that this identity could have a bearing on the way I read the recent events. If I may add, I am not associated with the government of Nepal or with any of the political parties. I'd further like to clarify that, as in the case of a high number of Nepali people, I did not celebrate the promulgation of the constitution, neither did I actively oppose it. And I would also like to mention that a significant number of Nepalese are of the same predicament as I am. I begin by exploring some of the linguistic and class diversity of Nepal. I examine Nepal's official discourse up to 2007. I then try to contrast this with the ordinary sociological realities that ordinary Nepalese have in their day-to-day lives. I then try to delve into more contemporary issues, the Constitution Assembly's constitution writing, and the protests in the Tarai led by Samyukta Loktantrik Madhesi Morcha. I then try to wrap up by thinking through Madhesi sub-nationalism and how this has impinged on existing Nepal-India relations. Nepal, as in the case of India, is a culturally and linguistically plural society, but the plurality is at a much smaller scale. We have some 26 million people, 123 language and dialects. Around 45% of the population identify Nepali language as their mother tongue, and around 81% identify themselves as Hindu. Nepal is probably the oldest state in South Asia, if I'm not mistaken, came into existence as back as 1769 and has had an uninterrupted existence. Though Nepal is an old state, it is an evolving nation. While Nepal remained a unitary Hindu kingdom during much of its existence, it is being reimagined and redesigned as a multi-ethnic, multicultural, and multi-religious nation. It is also being reformulated as a democratic, federal, secular republic. The official discourse up to 2007 posited Nepal to be very different from India. You know, India looms in the background as a pervasive, encompassing, and somewhat threatening entity, the difference with who needs to be constantly reiterated so as to clearly delineate one's own identity. It is through this process of contrasting oneself from the pervasive other, that is India, that then helped to chart out Nepal's own distinctive identity. If the Indian constitution defined the Indian state as a republic, Nepal's many constitutions prior to 2007 defined Nepal as a kingdom. Likewise, these defined the country as Hindu vis-a-vis India, which was secular, and likewise the country as being a unitary state vis-a-vis India, which was a federal state. Taking clue from Edward Said's Orientalism, one could argue that the India of Nepali state discourses reveals a reverse Orientalism. It can be called a reverse Orientalism in that the nation sees itself as being exotic, pristine, and unique. It is a discourse of a small self that defines itself in this manner, perceiving itself as being threatened and enveloped by the larger other. Now, while official discourses may see India as the other, for ordinary Nepalese, there were in fact many Indias. There was the India of the religious spiritual cosmos, the India of the soldier's world, the India of marketplace and informal economy, India of educational institutions, including that of Hindu Pathshalas. And finally, there is the India of cross-border kith and kin, Sarat ke us paar. These many Indias overlap, and though associated with the state of India, are associated with different sociologies, and thus for practical purposes constitute different Indias. Ordinary Nepali men and women, whatever their caste or ethnic groups or religious activities or geographic origins, interact with these Indias in their day-to-day lives. First is the India of the religious spiritual world. Every Hindu ritual in Nepal begins with the invocation Bharat Varshe Himot Khande Nepal Deshe. The invocatory mantra locates the existence of Nepal in the geobody of Bharat. And here I think there is a difference between Sri Lanka Buddhist tradition and the Hindu tradition. You know, Bharat is Varsha is specifically mentioned. Without offering water to the deceased ancestors in Gaya and or Kashi, the very purpose of existence remains unfulfilled. And every Nepali Hindu who has the means to do so goes on a pilgrimage to these sites, and if has the resources also to char dhams in four corners of Bharat Varsha. Just as the Nepali Hindus have their cosmologies and sacred spaces within the geobody of India, so too the Nepali Buddhists. It is the dream of every Nepali Buddhist to follow the footprints of Shakyamuni Gautam, the pilgrimage of which would take him or her to different locations, beginning with Lumbini in currently Nepal, to Rajgir, Bodhgaya, Sarnath, Sravasti, and Kushinagar. The Buddhist pilgrimage route, needless to say, intersects with those of the Hindus in many locales, notably the Gaya Bodhgaya and Kashi Sarnath, and so does their worldviews and cosmologies. The religious world of the Muslims of Nepal is not too different either. When they have the means to do so, Nepali Muslims would like to travel to sacred locales in northern India, among which the following stand out: Khwaja Garib Nawaz, the Mazar of Moinuddin Chisti in Ajmer, Kichosa Sharif, which is the Dargah of Mukhdum Shah in Faizabad, Ghazi Baba, the Dargah of Mahsud Ghazi in Baraich, and Ghause Bangla, a Sufi saint whose Dargah is located in West Bengal, and the various mazars and dargahs of Delhi, of which Nizamuddin stands out. Thus, the religious world of Nepalese, be they Hindu, Buddhist, or Muslims, cannot be disentangled from the geobody of India. Second is the soldier's universe. In Nepal, as mentioned in the preceding sections, some hill communities have had a long tradition of serving in the British Indian Army, and subsequent to the partition of the Gorkha Brigade, serving in the Indian and British armies. The India of the soldiers' universe is a world of Gorkha Brigade and the various battalions, regiments, companies, and platoons within it. Sometimes when a Nepali is asked for his identity, the answer is 1st Platoon, 3rd Regiment, Gorkha Brigade. In a sense, the identity within the army cosmology is more important than the state of which he is a citizen. There is even a specific name for babies born within army cantonments. These boys and girls are known as line chokda or line chokdi. When asked where they were born, the response would not be that he or she comes from so and so district, but then he is a line chokda, meaning that he was born within an army cantonment in India. Needless to say, thousands of Nepali jawans have been martyred. For many of these people whose families have served in the Indian army for generations, Nepal and India are misnomers. For hundreds of thousands of Nepalese and India, tied together by bonds of honor and sacrifice, the relationship is more steady than the vacillating relationship between Delhi and Kathmandu. Then there is the India of educational institutions, the India of colleges and universities. Before 1951, Nepal did not have modern education, and many of the requirements for exposure to modern education were met by institutions in India. No less significant than modern education has been the India of Vedic Pathshalas, which has been a refuge for many of destitute Brahmins who have fled hill poverty and have received education, traditional Sanskrit education, be these in Kashi or Vrindavan, in Haridwar or Rishikesh. Then there is the India of the marketplace and the informal economy. Thousands of Nepalese cross the border every day to buy inexpensive Indian goods to meet their daily needs and cross back. One could say that the modern metaphor for this is the India of India is the Dukan. Allied to the above is the India where a substantive number of Nepalese go to look for work. The big Indian economy makes possible employment, whether they are from the hills or the Tarai. Hill Nepalese have found a niche for themselves either in the security sector or in heat hotel business, where they serve as restaurant boys. For many poor lads in the hills, where there are no employment to come by, India is the Karmasthal, the land of their work. Then, no less important than all of these, is the India of the cross-border kith and kin, the India as Sarad ki us paar, seen from the side of Nepal. For many of the Tarai, India especially close to the Maithili, Bhojpuri and Awadhi-speaking Nepali Madhesis, for many of these Tarai residents, home could be in the Indian side of the border, while mother's maternal home or in-laws would be on the Indian side of the border, vice versa. For some families, some farms may be this side, some farms on the other side. This intense relationship between Nepal Tarai and Northern Bihar and Northeastern UP has been characterized as Roti Beti Ka Samandh. This region and the people, it epitomize what Frederick Gage, who has studied the particular Tarai region, refers to as the Gangetic civilizational sphere. This becomes evident from the dress, the mannerisms, etc. Just to give you an example, you know, if a hill person has access to television and will turn on Nepal TV or Kantipur TV, a Madhesi person could also watch Kantipur television, but would also be watching Aztak. If a hill person would be listening to Nepali BBC Hindi Seva, Nepali Seva, then the Madhesi person, besides the Nepali Seva, would also be listening to Hindi Seva. But in spite of these multifaceted relationships with the people of Nepal and the many Indians, you know, as we can see from the recent incidents, certain chills develop. And these chills have had to do with the recently formulated constitution, which has been dealt with adequately by Professor Krishna Hatichu, issues of citizenship, proportional inclusion, electoral system, federal boundary, and the preamble of the constitution. We have, for those of you who have followed the news for the past several weeks, we have come to learn about the so-called what the Nepali media calls the undeclared embargo by Nepal, by India, and the consequence hardships that have been faced by a lot of people in various parts of Nepal, including Kathmandu. Here I may want to add that, you know, although there is a multifaceted relationship, what is very peculiar about the Tarai Madhes, and which does not prevail for hill people, is that there tends to be a lot of cross-boundary relationships. whereas for the main hill communities, the marital relationships, so on and so forth, tends to be within the geography of Nepal. The events that transpire and continue to transpire show how Tarai Madhesi sub-nationalism in Nepal and the public sentiment in northern Bihar and northern eastern Uttar Pradesh have a repercussion on the dealings between New Delhi and Kathmandu. It also demonstrates the extent to which common culture affects or does not affect Nepal-India relations. Thank you.